It is frightening. When government misbehaves, when people use government for their own personal reasons, whether to promote an ideology
or self-aggrandizement.
And not doing one simple thing, problem solve for people, notwithstanding party. Once you're elected, put it aside and say, you know what, if I serve for one term, let it be that I represented the best principles that we believe in, and that is to problem solve and help people. Wherever it may be, it could be in the Gulf of Mexico, it could be anywhere in the subways of New York and around the country. But problem solve. Get involved with people. Whether it's an immigration issue in Arizona, Texas, or wherever else, problem solve. Don't get involved in dealing with an ideology as opposed to trying to help people be secure in their own place of business and home and on the street. That, to me, is what our government should be doing primarily.
Hear, hear. And what happens, tell me about the people, the Grail, and the others who are, what, the underground people, because I don't think they can live in Grand Central anymore. Everything is locked up.
There's an estimate of between, and this is from the city of New York, there's an estimate of between 5,000 to 25,000 people who are living in the tunnel areas underneath the ground in New York City. Most of them are in Manhattan, and one of the reasons is that when you see the skyscrapers of Manhattan, they just weren't placed there, obviously, on the surface.
Mm-hmm.
They have dug down and touched a piece of that rock, and in so doing, the construction people had a tunnel in and out, and they remain. In addition to which, there are many abandoned subway terminals underground, and we have many homeless people who are living there.
Well, I can believe they were, but this is before 9/11. After, I think they've closed up all of those.
Well, the reason why they're still living there is that, you're right, 9/11 did not take into account a lot of the people who were involved living in the Hudson Tube area, which was the area in the World Trade Center where people would go from Manhattan and commute to Hoboken, New Jersey. That was one of the major areas, and the other is Grand Central, as you say, and the reason for it is that when New Yorkers are awake in the morning and a couple of million people come into Manhattan, commuters and visitors, tourists, they at 6 o'clock in the morning, starting at that point, have their coffee, their bagels, their bialys, their muffins. It's all fresh because the food is coming in from 4 a.m. to 6 a.m. At night at 5 o'clock, when all of these eateries are closing down and they're going to toss out the remainder, the homeless people come up. And so we know that they're still there. Many of them are addicted either to alcohol, drugs, or otherwise, but many are homeless, and there are some children down there.
Yeah.
And it's one of the great blights we have in our society. Now, people are choosing to do it. It's something that needs to be addressed with respect to making sure we have a safety net in some fashion that gives people the opportunity not to live in the tunnels of New York, but to live in some fashion that has some dignity and some job training that will put people back into the mainstream.
Yeah.
But I use that as an example of our Greek chorus, if you will, because they're very much involved with helping the Karp family crime fighters survive against the evildoers who are lurking around.
Because even when Dirty Warren is in jail and he's got people who are coming on after him, suddenly there is our friend Mr. Grail and his followers who, but they also are equally, they're fighters for good, but they're using evil tactics. They will kill.
They will kill, and they have killed, and that's why there's that natural tension that exists between the district attorney, our hero, Mr. Karp, and Mr. David Grail, who was a former lay activist in the Catholic community, helping those in need, and now he's living down with these people, these godforsaken individuals, trying to help them, and at the same time dealing with evil and trying to protect the Karp family.
Bob, all of these people are so real, and you have been writing this for many years. Do you go home and are they with you all the time? I mean, it's sort of hard to, how do you walk out of that world to be Bob Tannenbaum?
Well, Patty and I have been blessed for many reasons. We just celebrated our 43rd wedding anniversary a couple of weeks ago, and we were married when we were at Berkeley together at the University of California. And when we went to Manhattan, and I always wanted to work for Frank Hogan, I've always been a great observer, and I thought that the people in and around the courts were absolutely an amazing cadre of everything in the spectrum on human behavior. And I volunteered for everything, all duties, whether it go to Bellevue Hospital and conduct competency hearings, or go up into Spanish Harlem and tour the precincts. I volunteered and met everybody I could. And these are the people now who exist in my novels. And they're wonderful people. Many people are afraid. They see the homeless and they're fearful. It's part of what I'm trying to do with all these books. And the book on American Exceptionalism, Betrayed, is for us to use the values that we have of our mind, as expressed in the Declaration and in the Constitution, and make that into reality.
Bob, you've signed my book. And I have to say, there is a brilliant new book by Frances Noble and her son, Ian, Blanket of Stars, Homeless Women in Santa Monica. Now, it isn't just New York that has the homeless. There you saw the women. And if you walk along the beach, there they are trying to get a rest, trying to do something. It is really a fantastic book. It could be probably any city in America. And support your local library, because if libraries are closed permanently, we lose part of America's brain. It is where people who are homeless can go and at least take a course in computers. They can take out a book. They can find a home away from home. And things that, whenever the economy is bad, the first to suffer is the public library. So I suggest go there. And if you want some other good reading, go back to the old books of Bob Tannenbaum, including one that was the first book, The Piano Teacher, nonfiction, but a book that will grasp. And let me know what you've been reading. Visit me on the web at www.ConnieMartinson.com, or go to YouTube, Connie Martinson Channel, it's called, and you can see the most recent shows if you've missed them. And what have you been reading? Let me know. Talks Books at Lycos. And we'll see you next time. Thank you, Bob.
Thank you very much.